Welcome back to New Day. Donald Trump repeating once again a false claim that he watched top secret video of Iranian officials unloading cash in exchange for U.S. prisoners. Watch. All right, so his own campaign, also Secretary of State John Kerry, disputing that. The Trump camp even came out yesterday acknowledging there is no tape. Let's talk about this. What's the story? Back with us. Jackie, let me begin with you. I mean, there is no tape. That is clear. So, A, what's the strategy doubling down? But B, also, and perhaps even more significant for his campaign, when you look at the polls right now, when he needs to make up a lot of ground, isn't this a big missed opportunity for him to focus on where the actual outrage is over the actual facts that we know that all the other Republicans are harping on, and he's talking about videotape?
When does Donald...
It's a mistake. The second day you do it, when everyone in the world said it, the video doesn't exist, and you go into even greater detail, it's just bizarre. I mean, it's just bizarre. But Jim Sciutto, to the actual substance of the Iran situation right now, and there's a lot going on there. I mean, Republicans are outraged. They say this shows there was a quid pro quo. This is paying ransom to get hostages back. President Obama was completely dismissive of that entire notion yesterday.
He was. And listen, there are some people imprisoning them on false charges. They're basically...
Some of the words that the president used yesterday, he said, and I'm paraphrasing here, sort of, you know, this looks like a spy novel. This looks like something much more than it is. You're making far too much out of this. Did you feel at all that he was writing off the legitimate concerns that many of his opponents have by phrasing it in that way?
Well, sure. He was clearly trying to get Vaughn. He has, in this case, I think, somebody in the form of Donald Trump who could be the leading critic with a great platform to call attention to what's wrong with this or what's troubling about this. And, of course, as we just noted, Trump is in no position. Now, he's not going to be the person to fact-check this, drive home a point.
This is an important discussion about U.S. foreign policy, about what the U.S. should and shouldn't do. This is the type of thing that should be debated in a campaign. There should be a difference of opinions here. So in that sense, you know, it's refreshing to see this discussion go on, right? I'm curious, Jackie, what the Clinton campaign thinks of all of this, right? Because they point out that, hey, Hillary Clinton, she wasn't actually Secretary of State when this cash was exchanged. She wasn't part of the negotiation on that track, if, in fact, as Jim points out, there were three different tracks that the Obama administration says. She wasn't part of that third, you know, $400 million track here. So there's a little bit of distance they're trying to create there, even as they say, you know, we believe the president on all of this.
They've pulled the president so close in this campaign. I don't know that it matters, that these details matter, particularly that he just hasn't picked up that mantle.
And a U.S. official came out yesterday and told Elise Labbitt it's, quote, unknowable if the prisoners would have been released if this cash hadn't come over. I mean, that's from a U.S. official saying, all right, we don't totally know, but they were separate tracks. Jim Sciutto, Senator Tom Cotton of Arkansas came out and he said this breaks with longstanding U.S. policy to put a price on the head of Americans, and it has making Americans less safe.
And listen, it's a vulnerable...
Errol, Jackie. Thanks so much.
All right, let the games begin. Tonight is the night, the opening ceremony. President Obama striking down critics who say that the United States paid, quote-unquote, ransom for four American prisoners held in Iran. Let's discuss this. CNN political commentator, former CIA counter. Let me begin with you. You reported on it then. You're reporting on it now. He says, the president says, basically, you, the press, are making too much of this. But as you've reported, his own Justice Department was very uncomfortable with the optics of a plane filled with cash flying the same day, dropping it off, that a plane was going the other way with hostages to Geneva. His own Justice Department.
No question. I mean, you have the optics there.
She'll tell our Elise Labbitt yesterday, and I quote, it's unknowable if it would have happened if the money didn't come.
He did.
True at the same time. It can be true that the president said that money was going to Iran, which he did say, you know, and Josh Earnest did brief, and it was written about in the New York Times. That can be true. It can also be true that the hostages would not have been released without that money. It could be that there was a quid pro quo, correct?
It's possible the Obama administration make the right call. I think they did make the right call. If they had to a special international tribunal, the AP has reported that the Obama administration had concluded we were going to lose, which meant we were going to pay significantly more money than ultimately in this settlement, and we wouldn't have gotten the hostages. So given that we were going to probably have to pay more money anyway and would have gotten nothing, I think this looks like a pretty good deal.
Buck Sexton, to you.
No, look, when you look at the time...
Aware of what the right hand's doing, what they're saying is this was not a quid pro quo. These were negotiated...
Oh, no, I understand
separately
what they're saying, but that's nonsense. I mean, the idea... Why not avoid raising the question in the first place? Why not say, we'll get you your cash, let's wait a little bit, this looks bad? If the reason is because the Iranians wanted to get the rest of the deal in place, they thought it would look particularly strong and good, right. And so they made this concession along with a whole bunch of others, including, of course, the initial prisoner swap. But this idea that the timing is coincidental is nonsense, and the administration should just own up to it. They should say, look, we wanted to release this extra cash because it was a sweetener needed to get the deal done. At least be honest with you.
On CBS this morning, Jim, I just want to jump in because we have some new sound from Vice Presidential candidate Tim Kaine, who was pressed about this issue and what he would do if in office on something like this on CBS this morning. Let's play it.
Let me ask you this. He says perception is one thing, reality is another. When it comes to dealing with foreign actors, whether it be rogue nations or terrorists, isn't perception in some cases reality if they think they can take hostages and get money, if they perceive that to be the case? Isn't that dangerous?
Well, to that, does this make Americans less safe? If you think back to comparisons that some are making to Iran-Contra and saying, look what happened in the wake of that, right? Hezbollah taking more Americans hostage in Lebanon. Could we see the same thing here? Does this embolden Iran, as Jim said in the last hour, taking, you know, Americans after the nuclear agreement was made? Does this make Americans less safe?
No, I don't think so. Again,
money, the perception.
Well, look, we will see, but I think that if perceptions are based on reality,
more time
right, a year in.
I hear. All right.
Just wait, but on the question.
Got to be short.
Of course.
Here's
you're
anyway.
Right, but for one, we have a deal now, which you're saying is a fantastic.
Buck, Peter, Jim, thanks so much. Really appreciate it. A tweet is making a lot of noise this morning. Donald Trump now.
Part of this interview all morning with a very special 11-year-old who you'll hear from in just a moment, because Donald Trump's running mate, Governor Mike Pence, took some tough questions dealing with some controversies on the campaign trail this week. But yesterday, Pence fielded perhaps one of the toughest questions he's faced yet from an 11-year-old. Beautiful Raleigh, North
Carolina.
Good morning,
Poppy.
Good morning to you, my friend. You told me you don't smile very much in the break, so we're going to try to. If you were, and you probably will be in the room with Donald Trump at some point, I think, maybe at one of these rallies coming up, what would you ask him? As his mother, watching him ask this question, what went through your mind? I think he did, you know, he caused Mike Pence to pause there for a moment. Made in this campaign of the language that is used, the name-calling that's been used, especially in the primary. As an 11-year-old watching it, what's your reaction? I know you have two other children, you have two young girls as well. So does the rhetoric of this campaign on both sides, does it bother you? A future politician, if I can even say that, only because of your awesome tie and your button, my friend. But really, do you have an interest? Sat down in the Oval Office, Matthew?
I don't know.
Very savvy 11-year-old. Thank you so much, Matthew and Mary. Have a great weekend, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You too.
Nice to see you both. JB.
You know, already dodging questions.
The president also facing tough questions about whether or not that $400 million payment to Iran was indeed ransom in exchange for those four U.S. prisoners. This as Trump repeats and repeats a false claim about actually seeing a video of that cash transfer in Tehran without any evidence of it actually existing. We begin our coverage this morning.